right now we're living in an epidemic of troubled people. People have lost a sense of purpose because you really need God for purpose. Ultimately, what it comes down to is your purpose can't be to feel good. When you take God out of the equation, that is all that's left. And it's an empty life. And it leads to a lot of self-harm and suicidal thinking, because what's the point? When you include God in there, and when you know Him, not just are religious, but when you know Him as your friend, and you get that experience of God rescuing you from circumstances, it reinforces that He's real. You know, I think a lot of us, speaking of financial troubles, I mean, who hasn't gone through that, you know, where you look at the situation and it looks hopeless and God somehow comes through. And those experiences of God repeatedly rescuing you, that reinforces His reality. I'm kind of glad for those experiences because it helps me remain calm whenever things are messed up, because I know, you know what, He helped me then and He'll help me again. As long as I'm trying, I just have to try. I have to not be in rebellion. I've just got to put forth some effort to try to do what He said. And He said, seek first His kingdom and His righteousness. All these things will be added to you. I will take care of you. Nothing's going to happen to you except that I will it. You know, and that gives us great comfort and giving us a purpose. You know, He's let us in on what His plan is for humanity, and He's given us the opportunity to take part in that. And, you know, when you sense God using your gifts to help other people, it gives us a sense of fulfillment that nothing can match. You don't want to give that up, because nothing can match that. There's no sin on earth that is as good as knowing that you're actually contributing to people's lives in a positive way, that God is using you to contribute. There's nothing that can replace that. Okay. So it's not the intense high that you get from certain behaviors, but it's a sustained fulfillment that is unmatchable. In chapter 3 of 2 Corinthians, we're going to discuss the law. And so I need to recap the law, and therefore we got to go back to the Old Testament. Now, question that comes up for people that aren't too familiar with the Bible, when they read the Old Testament for the first time, they're like, whoa! This is not the God of the New Testament. This is nothing like Jesus. Why does God seem so mean in the Old Testament? He's like a different person. First, we need to recognize, there's in order to get a picture, because you know, if you take a look at it, for one thing, the majority of the human population is alive right now. When you go back that far, the number of people that existed is a fraction of the people that exist today. God's plan all along was to, starting with Abraham, by faith, reach all the people of earth, to give people the opportunity to be His children. That was His plan all along. Now, part of the problem, though, is that when you become a child of God and you think you've earned it, bad things happen. Take a look at the angels. A whole lot of angels rebelled against God. All right, they did unspeakable things. And so one of the things that's necessary, if you're going to give free will, it's very important that the person you're giving the free will, if you're going to give somebody free will and power, they probably need to know what the rules are. The Old Testament is God saying, hey, look, here are the rules. Now, why is that important? Well, number one, one thing we learn from the law is that if we live by those rules, we can get along with each other better. It's better if we don't envy each other. It's better if we don't kill each other. It's better if we don't lie to each other. All kinds of things like that. So the law was given because God loved us and wanted us to get along and love each other. That's what He wanted. But also the law was given so that we would recognize sin inside ourselves, so that when God forgives us, we will be appreciative. All right, so there are reasons for this. Man at that time was very young, very stupid, primitive, if you will. So it's like when you have a child, do you treat that child like he's 21? No. Now, there are people that do. I have a good friend, and we talk on the phone maybe twice a month or whatever, and he was very upset last time I talked to him because his daughter, because he's my age, and so he has a daughter in her 30s, and she's raising her son like he's already an adult. what would you like to eat today? What do you want to do today? And she's letting him run the house. The kid has no respect for her. He's actually, when he was there, the kid got mad at her and punched her in the face, and she did nothing. Okay? It's a nightmare. It's a nightmare. You don't treat a child like adult. You don't give a child those kinds of freedoms. Man was very young at the time, and God had to be a parent with a stick. Now, was he still loving? Yes, but we were young, okay? We didn't know that much about God at that time. And so what he gave early man was he gave him the rules. And ultimately, we get to Jesus, and now we've got a pretty good population, and now the plan of salvation comes out. So now that promise to Abraham, God promised Abraham, I will bless all nations through you by faith. Well, now it applies. But that was a more primitive time. So anyway, let me move on. I'm going to explain that in a different way. So why was God so mean? When humans, on our own, when we think of heaven, one of the reasons that God seems so mean is that we think of heaven in terms of what we're going to get from our perspective. I think the best example of man making up heaven, well, there are two examples. One is the Elysian fields in the Greek religion. You know, if you die and you're bad, you go to Hades. If worse, you go to Tartarus. And if you're really good, you get to go to the Elysian fields. So you're going to, whatever you did in life, you're going to earn your afterlife. Or Muhammad, his idea of the afterlife. You get, 72 virgins, a flying red ruby horse, and you get to stay on a couch, and your women will just give you sex and grapes all day. You know, and think about this. Well, back in those days, a horse was really important. And so you go to heaven, you get a red ruby horse, you know, with wings. They'll fly you wherever you want to go. And who wouldn't want 72? it's like, how can they stay for anyway? it kind of doesn't make sense. But this is what man makes up. They think of, what do I really want? That's what God's going to give me because it's all about me. Actually, it's not. It's not all about us. We're not the first string. We're not the first creature of intelligence that God created. The B'nai Elohim were first, not us. The angels come out of those guys. We're second, all right? They were the first ones. And look what he shared with them, like everything. He included them on his council. He basically gave them power. And they were like, they were called the sons of God, okay? So they were given a lot of power. So look at man from God's perspective. Take a look at the big picture. Why did he make us? What is the point? That's important. Before we start judging, we got to step back and ask the question, what's the point? God's goal, it's very clear throughout Scripture, Old and New Testament, his goal has always been to use the human population for selective theosis. That's been his goal all along. All right? He wanted to get himself some children. He wants kids. Now,
what's selective theosis?
Theosis refers to the process by which we go from being just human to little Jesuses, to the sons and daughters of God. All right? Now that is a lofty aspiration. Nobody asked for that. I mean, nobody. Who asked for that? I didn't. When I became a Christian, I wasn't asking to be made into a small version of God. All right? I don't want to be a God. I just want to go to heaven. Okay? That's more than I wanted. But this is what he wants for us. That's very clear that this was his plan the whole time. I mean, when you read the New Testament, just go back and read John 16 and 17 and what Jesus was talking about. And it's going, wait a minute, this is more than, nobody asked for this. All right, you're going to share everything with us? Are you kidding? Everything? That's more than what we wanted here. But you want us to grow up to be actual children of God. That's a lot of, I mean, the intellectual power, the awesome otherwise power. Imagine, let's say you're the only child of Elon Musk, and you're going to inherit SpaceX and Tesla and all this stuff. What would be the consequences if you had a child who's about to inherit, you know, $400 billion or whatever? It's going to be $400 or $500 billion. It's going to be a trillion. By the time you watch him 3 or 4 years, it's going to be a trillion. I mean, this guy, it's just going to keep going up, right? But imagine you have a kid that lacks self-control, selfish, narcissistic, antisocial, and greedy. What is the likelihood that that money and power is going to be used for evil? Very high. Is that what you want? Is that what you want? You need some rules here, okay? Imagine as an adult child of God, you know, I mean, God has the ability to bring forth whatever he thinks. That's a lot of power. So if that is what we're destined for, say when we go to the next realm and that is what we become, who are you going to trust with that kind of power? Who are you going to trust with that kind of knowledge? You guys remember there was a Twilight Zone with starring Billy Mummy, where the kid was born and he literally has godlike powers and he terrorizes his family. For those of you who haven't seen it, I'm going to show you a little clip.
You and her, you had him. You had to go have him. You are my sunshine, my only sunshine. You make me happy when I am blue. Monster, you. You dirty little monster. You murderer. You think about me. Go ahead, Anthony. You think bad thoughts about me. And maybe some man in this room, some man with guts, somebody who's so sick to death of living in this kind of place and willing to take a chance, sneak up behind you and lay something heavy across your skull. And end this once and for all.
You're a bad man. You're a very bad man.
You think that? Go ahead, Anthony. I'm a very bad man. Keep thinking that. Somebody sneak up behind him. Somebody end this now while he's thinking about me. Won't somebody take a lamp or a bottle or something and end this?
You're a bad man. You're a very bad man. And you keep thinking bad thoughts about me.
Wish it into the cornfield. Please, son, wish it into the cornfield, please.
He was a bad man, so I turned him into a jack-in-the-box. A jack-in-the-box that still had his bad face. And you mustn't think bad thoughts about me either, or I'll do the same thing to you.
So you see the tyranny here. You see the tyranny is that in our native state with free will, when there is rebellion, it makes everywhere a hell. That's the consequence of not having rules, of not having law. And, you know, you think about your own testimony. I think about my own testimony. My parents and grandparents and aunts and uncles and neighbors had no trouble telling me what a sinner I was. Okay, I got that news. By the time I was 10 years old, I was convinced that I was in trouble. Okay, and it was good because when I finally heard the truth, in the Bible, that Jesus died for my sins and that all my sins, past, present, and future, were completely forgiven, and I didn't have to do anything, that he loved me, and that all when he died on the cross, all this, I felt like this is great news. This is wonderful news. My gosh, why didn't you lead with that? All this time I thought I had to be perfect and give away every cent that I owned and all this kind of stuff. And so, but the thing is, it was those rules is what laid the groundwork to accept the message. Okay, that's what it did. You know, I'm not going to read through Galatians chapter 3, but the point here is simply that the law was there as a tutor to give people the basis for conscience and to give us a civilization. Think about how much Judaism and you know, even in Christianity have contributed to civilization in terms of those laws. It's given us civil governments, and as a matter of fact. So there was a reason, but the law in itself wasn't enough. Okay, it's the faith in him. Just like Abraham had, he believed God and it was counted as righteousness, and God promised him that through you all nations will be blessed. This same deal of having faith in me resulting in salvation, I want that for everybody through you. That was the purpose of the law. And so I want to recap this because you need that fresh in your mind when we get into Galatians 3, because he's going to be referring to that. So let's just do a real quick recap of Moses and the Ten Commandments here.
You probably all know about the Ten Plagues and the parting of the Red Sea, as well as the incident of manna falling from heaven. But are you aware of when Moses spent so much time in the presence of God that when he descended back down from Mount Sinai, his face was literally glowing so bright that the people were afraid to look at him if he didn't put a veil over his face? Yeah. Exodus 34 tells us about the shining face of Moses, and I didn't come up with that term, but I got it from Biblia's subsection heading of the ESV Bible. Why exactly was Moses' face shining? Well, we'll be discussing the entire thing in this installment of Unsung Bible Stories, where we present to you stories in the Bible you probably haven't heard about and are rarely preached or oversimplified in a church sermon. If the Bible was an anime, these would be the filler episodes that everyone skips over, trying to get to the main plot point episodes. If you are enjoying the video thus far, then why not consider leaving a like and subscribing for more installments of this series. But with that out of the way, let's dive into Exodus chapter 34, and I'll be reading from the ESV. When Moses came down from Mount Sinai with the two tablets of the testimony in his hand, as he came down from the mountain, Moses did not know that the skin of his face shone, because he had been talking with God. Aaron and all the people of Israel saw Moses, and behold, the skin of his face shone, and they were afraid to come near him. But Moses called to them, and Aaron and all the leaders of the congregation returned to him. And Moses talked with them. Afterward, all the people of Israel came near, and he commanded them all that the Lord had spoken with him in Mount Sinai. And when Moses had finished speaking with them, he put a veil over his face. Whenever Moses went in before the Lord to speak with him, he would remove the veil until he came out. And when he came out and told the people of Israel what he was commanded, the people of Israel would see the face of Moses. The skin of Moses' face was shining. And Moses would put the veil over his face again until he went in to speak with him. So that's a really short passage of the occasion, but let's get some context pulling from various Christian commentary sources. When God began to give the law to Israel, he did so accompanied by an overwhelming atmospheric display of thunder and lightning, smoke and fire, and the sound of a trumpet on the top of Mount Sinai. This was to warn the people that he is holy and should not be approached. Anyone who tried to come up the mountain would be killed. When God delivers the Ten Commandments, the people of Israel are so frightened that they are afraid to have God speak. They ask that Moses deliver the law instead, as we see in Exodus 20. So Moses approaches God and receives the law in Exodus 21 to 23. He delivers it to the people who are called to affirm their willingness to obey in chapter 24. In Exodus 25 to 31, Moses goes up to the mountain and receives the plans for the tabernacle and the tablets of stone on which God had engraved the Ten Commandments. Upon his return to the Israelite camp, Moses finds the Israelites worshipping the golden calf in violation of the law they had just agreed to. Israelites again. In anger, Moses smashes the stone tablets to bits and proceeds to address this sin in a camp, as you see in chapter 32. After the sin had been dealt with, God invites Moses to come back up the mountain to receive the law again, engraving on new tablets of stone. Moses goes up the mountain alone and meets with God. There he begs for pardon for the nation. God forgives and renews the covenant with Israel and once again provides a summary form of the law, the Ten Commandments. Moses spends 40 days and 40 nights with God on the mountain, and during that time he did not eat or drink. It seems that the glory of God sustained him. After spending this extended amount of time with God, Moses comes down the mountain and his face is shining with the glory of God. We don't know exactly what this would have looked like, but it was frightening to his brother Aaron, the high priest, and to all the rest of the people, because everyone was afraid to come near Moses. He wore a veil over his face to shroud the glory. We are not told how long this lasted, but presumably the glory began to fade when Moses was no longer regularly going into the presence of God. How long Moses wore the veil is unknown, but the veil is not mentioned during the remaining years of his leadership, which is roughly 38 years. That honestly is like one of my favorite snippets, like scriptures from like the entire saga of Moses, because it's like Moses spent so much time with God that his face began to glow. And the depiction of the Action Bible for me is how I saw it in my head, and it's just like, it's a wow. Spending so much time in God's presence, like literal back then, that you literally begin to glow with the glory of God. That's so cool. But with that, we'll end off this installment of Unsung Bible Stories.
Now, when I first read that many years ago, I never heard a near-death experience, so I've not had contact with, you know, people who describe dying and going through the tunnel and meeting God. Since then, I've heard thousands of stories. I've exposed you guys to a bunch of those stories, and one of the things they have in common is when you meet God on the other side, how do they describe him? How do they describe him? Yeah. Exactly. He's so bright, they said, that if you saw it with your eyes, it would burn your eyes out. That's how people describe the Lord. Across the board, consistently. I've not had a single person ever have a near-death experience that I believe was real. I've never seen that where they don't describe him that way. He's very bright. Too bright for human eyes. So Moses goes up that mountain, comes down looking like who? Looking like the Lord. Spending time in God's presence makes you look like him. That's what happens. Okay? Paul puts a spin on this. When we get into chapter 3 here, Paul says, the reason, now what we see in the text is that Aaron asked Moses, please put a veil on. We can't take this. This is too weird. You're too bright. Put something over that face of yours, because this is just crazy. And Paul adds, one of the reasons that Moses put the veil on also was he didn't want people to see that the shine was fading away. And so in chapter 3, Paul goes like, look, that glory that Moses had, well, because of Christ, because now we are the new B'nai Elohim, we have that light inside of us that's getting brighter and brighter and brighter. As we are remade in God's image, We are shining like that. Son of God is what B'nai Elohim means.
Not does it sound like we're patting ourselves on the back, insisting on our credentials, asserting our authority. Well, we're not. Neither do we need letters of endorsement, either to you or from you. Not are you yourselves are all the endorsement we need. Your very lives are a letter that anyone can read by just looking at you. Christ himself wrote it, not with ink, but with God's living spirit. Not chiseled into stone, but carved into human lives. And we publish it.
Okay, here Paul is saying, you know, for one thing, remember one of the conflicts with the Corinthians was that they were comparing him to people that could speak better. And he's saying, look, you know, I don't need to give you a letter of recommendation. I don't need you to recommend me. The fact that you guys have changed lives, that many of you are Christians and that process is taking place, that is the proof that this is real. Okay, look at your lives and compare that to the Ten Commandments chiseled on stone. This is what you have is in your life. It's in your heart. Okay, that is better than what Moses was offering. So that's how we're starting here. Let me move on.
We couldn't be more sure of ourselves in this. Yet you written by Christ himself for God are our letter of recommendation. We wouldn't think of writing this kind of letter about ourselves. Only God can write such a letter. His letter authorizes us to help carry out this new plan of action. The plan wasn't written out with ink on paper, with pages and pages of legal footnotes. Killing your spirit. It's written with spirit on spirit. It's life on our lives.
All right, so again, this is not unlike the law, which is this external codex, this external book of rules. This New Deal is inside of you. It's written on your heart. It's God in you, and way better than what was offered by in the Old Testament.
The government of death. It's a constitution chiseled on stone tablets. Had a dazzling inaugural. Moses' face as he delivered the tablets was so bright that day, even though it would fade soon enough, that the people of Israel could no more look right at him than stare into the sun. See? How much more dazzling? And then the government of living spirit.
Okay, so it refers to the law as the government of death. And why do you think he would call it the government of death? Why was the law referred to as the government of death? What happens if you violate the law? You're cut off from God. Basically, it was the rules that said, this is violate this and you're done. Violate this and you will not inherit the kingdom of God. All right, and he says, now look at a dazzling inaugural. I mean, look how it was introduced with lightning and flashing and Moses' face shining like the sun. Okay, look how exciting that was. So if that was God introducing phase one and it was inferior, think about what's coming now. This is way bigger than the introduction of the law, way more powerful, way more dazzling.
If the government of condemnation was impressive, how about this government of affirmation? Right as that old government was, it would look downright dull alongside this new one. If that makeshift arrangement impressed us, how much more this brightly shining government installed for eternity.
Okay, again, it's pretty straightforward. It's like, wow, if that was awesome, because think about how that was presented. I mean, think about all the things that led up to the giving of the law. It starts with the 10 plagues, because here, all of a sudden, for years and years, you have Abraham and a few miracles that, you know, like the Sodom and Gomorrah thing and Abraham's victories and the birth of Isaac. So there were miracles surrounding Abraham because of that little bit of faith that he had. Now, fast forward 430 years. 430 years, Abraham's children have gone to Egypt. Now they're out of Egypt and they're on the way to the promised land, and God gives the law. And so we have the plagues. We have God following the pillar of fire. We've got the manna from heaven. You got all these miracles, and now you have Mount Sinai with the lightning and thunder and Moses' face shining. So all of these miracles and the destruction of all those people that rebelled against Moses. So God is like just interacting in human history like crazy. And so he's making a contrast here. He's saying, man, think about how awesome this was. And how very clear it was, God's intervention in human history, and how impressive that was. Well, what we've got going now is more impressive than that. Because all you got to do to think about, where was the miracles? Well, look at Jesus. Look at Jesus. Look, the resurrection from the dead. All the people he rose from the dead. The walking on the water. The feeding of the 5,000. Okay, this is even bigger.
With that kind of hope to excite us, nothing holds us back. Unlike Moses, we have nothing to hide. Everything is out in the open with us. He wore a veil so the children of Israel wouldn't notice that the glory was fading away, and they didn't notice. They didn't notice it then, and they don't notice it now. Don't notice that there's nothing left behind that veil. Come on, even today when the proclamations of that old bankrupt government are read out, they can't see through it.
Only Christ can get rid of the veil so they can see for themselves that there's nothing there.
Okay, what veil is he talking about? Because there's a lot of meaning there, yeah. Well, you got to think back to the illustration that he's just given us. He's talking about when Moses came down, remember he was so bright, he had to have that veil to cover the glory because the glory was so intense. Okay, so basically that glory represents the process of theos, that represents God in a sense. And so, you know, now that, I mean, that veil was, think about, and Jesus, when he died on the cross, what happened when he died? The veil was torn in two. What did that signify? That the barrier between man and God is done. We now have that mediator, because before Christ died on the cross, then theologically, your sins weren't forgiven yet. It's very complicated because time works different in heaven and all that stuff. But anyway, from our perspective, from our temporal, weak perspective, the appearance is that prior to Jesus dying on the cross, if you committed a sin, even it would be counted against you, and there was no hope for you. Okay, and that's why they had to offer sacrifices for their sins, because there was atonement for sin. There needed to be atonement for sin. Before that comes into play, you need to understand what sin is. Okay, and so that veil, that there was that separation, because our sins separated us from God. We could not come before God because we were unclean. So we couldn't come in. We needed that veil. We couldn't come into the Holy of Holies because we were unclean. And now, with that veil being ripped in two, that veil over Moses' face that separated us from God's glory, that separation isn't there anymore. When Jesus died, that veil was taken away. And we get to, as Moses, be face to face with God. That's available to everybody now. Does that make sense? All right.
Whenever they turn to face God as Moses did. God removes the veil. And there they are, face to face. They suddenly recognize that God is a living, with personal presence, not a piece of chiseled stone. On when God is personally present, a living spirit, that old constricting legislation is recognized as obsolete. We're free of it, all of us, nothing between us and God, Ben. Our faces shining with the brightness of his face. And so we are transfigured much like the Messiah, our lives gradually becoming brighter and more beautiful as God enters our lives and we become like him.
That's the last verse. And in this is really interesting too here. I really love this. It's like when we are transfigured, much like the Messiah, our lives gradually becoming brighter and more beautiful as God enters our lives. Another phenomenon I've noticed in looking at near-death experiences is that when a non-Christian dies and has that experience and meets the Lord, when they look down at themselves, it's not uncommon to see that they're wearing bad clothes, either filthy clothes or there's dirt over them or whatever. I've seen that. Okay, they're dull compared to the Lord. When believers look down at themselves, they see that they're shining too. They're wearing these white robes and they're shining. All right, we can't see the shine with our human eyes, but outside of our body, the closer we walk with him, the brighter we become. But that's something that's seen with spiritual eyes. Like Moses, we shine. The more we're in his presence, it activates something inside of us. Okay, there's a mirroring effect, and we reflect that glory. But we only, as we follow him, we take on his shine, and we start to look like him. We start to actually look like the B'nai Elohim that he intended us to be. Okay, and that's a way better deal. That Moses, you know, the law had its purpose. It developed the core, the substructure of our moral compass, which is really important. It allowed us to experience legitimate shame. When I referred to that kid before who punched his mother and was very demanding and is out of control because mom treats him like a 21-year-old, all right, what is missing? What's missing is that child needs to understand that his poo-poo stinks. He needs to know that. He needs to be disciplined. He needs to understand that he needs to be forgiven. He needs to change. That is the purpose of the law. That is the purpose of the commandments. It's really essential that we get our free will under control with rules. But having said that, then now we can relax and say, okay, we don't have to be freaking out about every single rule now. Our goal is to follow Christ, do what we can, accept that forgiveness, and shine without worrying about being cast aside because of one breaking of the rule, one episode of breaking of the rules. Okay. Is that okay?